begun, and you can tell by just looking outside. Some announcements to begin with. October is a big month. Got a lot going on. Starting Sunday the 1st, next Sunday is our communion breakfast. We're going to have our service around a breakfast table, basically, one big breakfast table. So we'll eat breakfast together as well as worship together around the table and partake in communion, which is Sunday is World Communion Sunday. Also, yeah.
I have a question. What time do you need to be here if you're helping with the breakfast?
I'll get back to you.
Okay.
8:30, I think, is the time we've been talking about, but I want to make sure. October 7th is our first concert in October. We have a couple concerts. The first concert is an organ concert by an organ maestro based in Middletown. His name is Ron Ebricht. He's a wonderful organist, a professor of organ. Don't miss that. That's October 7th at 7 p.m. And then a couple, 3 weeks later, on a Sunday, October 29th, Kayla Farnan, who is our state troubadour, musician troubadour, she'll be playing a show for us October 29th at 3 p.m. Maybe you're seeing all the marketing and the advertisements about these two shows. I do pray that you'll partake of them. I'm sure you won't be disappointed. Neighbors in Need is next week, just to let you know about that, as usual. Our Fellowship About Nothing will begin, come back October 2nd. So October 2nd, a Monday at 7 p.m. here in the parlor. It's exactly what it is advertised to be, a gathering, a fellowship about nothing, inspired by the Seinfeld TV show. I think that's it. Anything I'm missing that really needs to be announced as we begin? No? So let us take a deep breath, receive God's presence here this morning, and let us join together in the worship covenant. O God, we covenant to worship you with our whole being this morning. We give to you our vulnerabilities and humanness, and pray you will encompass us with the light of your grace. We look to your perfect compassion, which we pray will fill us in turn, O God, as we worship you in word, in song, and in truth. Amen.
Let us sing together number 38 in your pilgrim hymnal, the red hymnal, Morning Has Broken. of silence. Let us pray. O loving God, as we begin this time of worship, I pray that you will remind us, transform our minds, reframing them to better see you and your love. Clear away the peripherals, the baggage, the distractions. May we be empty this morning of all but you and the knowledge of your grace in our midst. In these moments, may we know all is well with our souls. In this sanctuary, in these moments, life's busyness is at bay. All the noise has subsided. The TV is off. Our phones are away. It's just ourselves and you, O God. May your presence and our presence with you filter into our hearts, moving us to see your compassion and seeking to follow it, to experience your love and in turn to love you and others, doing so with greater simplicity and simple purpose. For it's in your simple name, the name of love, we pray. Amen. Let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We're excited to share with you some valuable information about an amazing about the amazing initiative known as Neighbors in Need, created by the United Church of Christ. Neighbors in Need is a program that embodies the UCC's commitment to social justice, community support, and compassionate outreach. With the money raised through churches, Neighbors in Need is able to help out in many ways. With the money raised, they can combat the ongoing issue of hunger by supporting local food banks, community kitchens, and meal programs. They also advocate for policies and actions that promote justice, equity, and inclusion. In times of crisis, such as natural disasters, which we are seeing a lot of now, or for unforeseen emergencies, Neighbors in Need provide swift and effective relief to affected communities and families, offering both financial and material support. Neighbors in Need is a special mission offering within the United Church of Christ and is a testament to the UCC's dedication to living out the teachings of Jesus by providing tangible support to those in need. On October 1st, as a part of our World Communion Sunday observance, you will receive a Neighbors in Need offering. Donations are an amazing way to support this mission if you are able to give. This is your mission and mine. Thank you.
All right, I think, Luke, you're the only one. Come on down. Well, we all got your sister. She's a good old lady, right? She's pretty much an adult. So how's it feel to be the only one? Yeah? It's about how Jesus loves the lost, or goes after the lost sheep in this case, more than anything. He'll leave the 99 others to go after that one lost sheep, and that's what the story is all about. All sorts of people flocked to hear Jesus. Some followed God's ways, and some did not. Jesus treated everyone with love and kindness. Some of the teachers did not like this, and they complained, "Just look at him sitting down and eating with those people. I would never." Jesus heard their grumbling, so he told them a story. Once there was a shepherd who had 100 sheep, including an old, smelly ram that was always getting into trouble. One day, the old ram wandered off. The shepherd could have said, "Good riddance. That one was nothing but a nuisance," but he did not, leaving the other 99 peace, perfectly well-behaved sheep. He searched all night, in the cold and the rain. At last, the shepherd found that old ram in a ditch. He was covered with mud. Boy, did he smell, but the shepherd didn't mind one bit. He put the ram on his shoulders and carried him all the way home singing. Then he called his friends and had a party. "I have found the sheep that was lost," he shouted. "It is the same in heaven," Jesus explained. "The angels have a party every time someone who was lost comes back to God." So here's the prayer you can take with you. Dear God, help me to care about everyone like Jesus does. All right, that's the story. Simple as that. But very, very hard at the same time. To follow the goal, let's see it.
Amen.
sing together once more, number 225 again in your pilgrim hymnal. Our beautiful pilgrim hymnal, 225, Jesus the Very Thought of Thee. Psalm of the week comes from Psalm 145. It is Psalm 145. And my favorite, poor Bishop Hooper sings it this morning. So let us hear it, listen reflectively, even follow along in your Bibles if you'd like. This is, I did hear poor Bishop Hooper, Psalm 145.
Love, steadfast love.
Turn to our New Testament readings. We begin with our gospel reading, Matthew 18, chapter 21 through 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for the vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idly in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" He said to them, "Because no one has hired us. He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call all the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they of course grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. The good news of God, thanks be to God. And for our second New Testament reading, we turn to 1 Corinthians 15, verses 42 through 49. "So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in Honor, it is raised in glory. It is so in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a physical as physical. It is sown a physical body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body. For it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the physical, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we will also bear the image of the one of heaven. Amen. So this is the sort of the climax of a sermon series I've been focused on these past few weeks. It's a three-part sermon series, and this is the third sermon. So we've discussed up to this point who we are, how we were created to be in God's divine image. We've discussed how this divine image is covered over with the baggage of our humanness. Now we turn to the one who removes that baggage and returns us to our original state, our divine nature, our divine image. We turn to the one who finds us east of Eden, gathers us, shepherds us, and lays down his life to be a bridge back to Eden. Imagine a huge bridge over troubled waters, a huge flow, a huge stream of people walking that bridge from east of Eden into Eden. For each individual in that stream of people, Christ is their personal bridge to God. A bridge to the garden of their own hearts. A bridge to a relationship with God. A bridge back to our original nature, our divine image. Christ, through his work on the cross, we can't forget the cross, removes the baggage covering that divine image, allowing us to begin again. What a gift to begin again. We can say Jesus wipes the slate clean, getting us back to square one, where we are at one with God. Christ on the cross at-one'd us, atoned us. Christ returns us to Eden, into the intimate relationship with God that Adam and Eve had in the Garden of Eden. But there's a collective level to all of this, and we can't miss that collective level. That stream of people on the bridge we can call Christ, that stream of the people, what is that? What is that stream? That is us, the church. If you've personally internalized and affirmed the Christian faith, you are part of the Eden-bound people called the church. You are on the bridge, all of you. Sure, you can choose not to be involved in the church, the collective church body, the community walking with you in some sense. But how sad and lonely would this be? How hard it would be walking with a community beside you, but remaining aloof and alone. Alone in a crowd. We've all felt that. And it's not a fun feeling to have. But someone part of the church, but not walking aside the community with them, pretty hard, I'd say. Lonely. And we're struggling with a loneliness epidemic. If you are a Christian, you are a member of the Christian community. Christ purchased your membership. Whether you make the most of that membership, that's up to you, of course. I pray as a pastor, you will make the most of it. But free will is involved. Here's something else to think about. A bridge as a function, what does it mean? We move from one side to the next. That's the bridge's purpose, to move from one side to the other side. A bridge never taken, never used. Is it really a bridge? Have you ever thought about that? A bridge that is never used, you never see a person walking over it. It sits there isolated and alone in itself. Christ without the church is like a bridge without people crossing it. Christ works through community. Christ works through community. Christ works through the church. Imagine the Golden Gate Bridge. It was simply there to look at, not to take. Not serving a purpose, but just to be there. Christ, the bridge, needs us. Christ needs us to take that bridge and be the church, to be his body, the body of Christ progressing forward in the world. But it goes even further than this. And we shouldn't miss this part. Remember last week we talked about a disturbance in the force that came as a result of that unwise choice in the garden. Adam and Eve's act of selfishness, as small as it seemed, had immense ramifications. Their choosing of self and disregarding of God gave way to a huge imbalance in creation. This is what the Christian church has traditionally taught. It's part of Christian doctrine, as we say. But maybe you're thinking, this makes kind of no sense. How can taking a simple bite of a fruit lead to all of this? Well, have you ever heard the name Vasily Arkhipov? Arkhipov. No, I hadn't either. But he's been called the man who saved the world. Did you know that? Here's a description from the Farnham Street blog, a wonderful blog. Arkhipov was a Russian naval officer in November 1963. For the historians among you or those who lived through it, you know what that means. He was stationed on a nuclear-armed submarine near Cuba. In November of that year, American aircraft and ships began using depth charges to signal the Russian submarine that it should surface so it could be identified. With the submarine submerged too deep to monitor radio signals, the crew had no idea what was going on in the world above. Isolated and alone. The captain, his name was Savitsky, decided the signal meant that war had broken out. And he prepared to launch a nuclear torpedo. Everyone agreed with him except Vasily Arkhipov. Had the torpedo launched a nuclear cloud, would have hit Moscow, London, East Anglia, and Germany before wiping out half of the British population. The result could have been a worldwide nuclear holocaust as countries retaliated and the conflict spread. Yet within an overheated underwater room, Vasily Arkhipov exercised his veto power and prevented the launch. Without the courage of one man in that moment, our world could have been unimaginably different. So the notion of one small act or decision having immense impact, it is known as the butterfly effect, and we see it throughout history and even in our own lives, I think. And Adam and Eve are sort of the archetype of this butterfly effect. Their small act of eating that fruit, selfishly disobeying God, is a microcosm of all of creation being marred by human selfishness. But enter Christ. Enter Christ. Christ in his utter selflessness. Selflessness on the cross reversed the trend, as the teaching goes. Turned the tide back and will restore balance to creation. Not only that, Christ and Christ's selflessness, compassion, will eventually end in the restoration of all of creation. Not just us, but all of creation. Eden is the end game for all things. And the compassion of Christ, that simple decision, "Thy will be done," gave way to compassion getting us there. Anyone who's attended church for a bit of time knows that the gospel literally means what? Good news. This good news, we often shrink it to mean just for us human beings, us here and now. We shrink it. It becomes my good news, my story of redemption. Jesus redeemed me and set me free. But the good news is not just for us as individuals, it's not just for us as a human species. No, the good news is for all the world. For God so loved what? Not me or you. For God so loved the world. It is not just peace in our neighborhoods or among a small pocket of people. It is peace on earth. The wolf shall live with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the young goat. The calf and the lion will feed together, and a little child shall lead them. Christ and compassion on the cross, it is the pivot point for creation and for all things in creation, returning us eventually to God. Acts 3, a story about Paul preaching to Greeks, it talks about the restoration of all things through Christ. The restoration of all things. That is the good news we preach. And can you get any better than that? All things will be restored. So the simple takeaway is this. Share that good news. The goodest of news. With your deeds, and if you have to, with your words, be the living words of God in real time, being the bridge for others to the bridge that is Christ. And may our community walking that bridge together ever be full and growing. Amen. All right, does anyone have a prayer request? Joy, a sorrow, a concern to share?
Devastates a community for sure. Yes, Ellen.
I recently found out just this past week that the church I grew up in is having their last service next Sunday. They're closing.
Sorry.
The church has probably been there for over 100 years. I know my aunt, my grandparents went there.
Definitely a form of grief for sure. A deep form of grief.
It's the Second Reformed Church of Little Falls, New Jersey.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry to hear that. They're not alone, that's for sure. It's coming for our churches. Yes, Holly.
I have a joy. Last week I was saying how I'd gotten a text during service about my aunt Gloria, and they have found she's not in kidney failure, and she's been released from the hospital. And so she is, and this would be, I guess, this is a prayer request, she is a lifelong smoker, and therefore she has, some she has COPD, and not to go long, sorry, I'm trying to wrap it up. It's hard on the medical. emphysemic, you all that are medical, help me out, some emphysemic-like activity. But the kidneys, right? So that's the joy. And then somehow, this is part B, somehow this situation with my aunt made my mom become more responsive, shook her up in a way that she seems more serious about her own health. So that's a joy too.
Absolutely.
And an ongoing prayer request.
Yeah. Thank you. So and Gloria is free of kidney failure, which is really good. That's definitely a joy. Yeah. Rose.
Gabriel had his urology appointment and everything's healing and he's good to go.
Good. Gabriel's on the mend. Sure, maybe already back in school.
He's only one.
He's only one,
No school yet.
No school yet. All right, anyone else? All right, so let us join together in our prayer. Please join me. For those weighed down by ill health, bring wholeness to body, mind, and spirit. For those weighed down by worry, bring wisdom, peace, and reassurance. For those weighed down by fear, bring freedom, release, and liberation. For those weighed down by sadness, bring comfort, strength,
God, thank you for all the joys we actually know. Walk with us, beside us, and before us. Remind us and remind us that all is well, all manner of things will be well. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, let's sing once more. This is a tune I'm sure you know. It's a hymn that we often don't sing, number 213, Lord of All Hopefulness. 217.
Thank you.
good news, the goodest news. If necessary, use words. If more than anything, go in peace, sharing that peace with the world in need of it. I did want to remind you, if you're wanting to be part of the book club, we meet at 11:30 in the parlor. We'll be discussing the Great De-Churching, book discussing things like the closure of churches. So please join us at 11:30 in the parlor. Go in peace. Thank you.